What a year it has been for Next Man Up. Here we are in mid-February, and we've officially hit the NFL offseason. On today's season finale, we will reflect on Super Bowl 58, voice our concerns and visions for our favorite clubs, and tease our upcoming NFL draft show for the 2024 season. It's Next Man Up on Down the Rabbit Hole Media, and it all starts now.
What were all those plans we made now left beside the road? Behind us in the road. More than friends, I always pledge, cause friends they come and go. People change as does everything I
All right, gentlemen, obviously we're a man short on this main recording, but Nicky is going to submit some recordings for us, so we'll be able to intertwine that into the show. I'm Tony Joseph. I'm here with Big Chris. I'm here with Johnny P. And guys, we're in mourning. The season's over. Only, what, 200 Sundays till we get to 200 days, not 200 Sundays. That would be
364 days till next year's hockey tryouts. Got to get ready now.
Yeah, I
mean, gotta tough it up for next year.
Any coping mechanisms for this dark time?
I'm not gonna lie, Anthony. I think I started a mini depression yesterday, not having football on for the first time, and I can't remember how long. And now we're, you know, almost 200 something days out until the next NFL season begins. And obviously, you know, the scouting combine begins next week. We're about a month out from NFL free agency, but I just don't know what to do with myself. This awkward gap between the end of the Super Bowl and when March Madness begins, like, I have no interest in the NBA All-Star game, whatever the hell that was this past weekend.
And NBA All-Star exhibition, no defense show.
The outdoor NHL series, like, those look cool. I don't know any of the players, but like, they looked cool. I watched a little bit of that, but like, I need football in my life. I'm a happier John with football in my life. You guys know this. Do you guys go through something similar? This mini depression between football season and March Madness, or just the draft in general? I need football. I just need football.
I mean, absolutely. I mean, we have basketball and hockey going on right now, and you know, we have the notes from spring training with baseball right around the corner. But you know, it's one of those things where it's like, I eat, sleep, and breathe football. If you look around my basement, I have sports everywhere. I mean, you can see I have football behind me, I have hockey flanking me, but primarily there's football down here. And it's just, you know, that's my happy season. You know, everyone's like, what's your favorite season? It's football season. And it always will be.
It's chicken soup for the soul. You know, it's that's what it is.
Even though it's perpetual misery for us, you know, as the fans of the teams that we are.
Yeah.
It's just, we still look forward to it for whatever reason.
Yeah.
I mean, honestly, I feel like there's this horrible gap we have between football and everything. Like, look, I'm an all around sports fan. I like baseball. I like hockey. I like basketball. I'll watch pretty much anything that's competitive. But the sacred ritual of Sundays and Monday nights and, you know, Thursdays too sometimes. But just that like, you know, your team is on once a week and you revolve your entire schedule around that team. To me, it's like, I don't mean to offend anybody, but to me, it's like church. Like, that's like the schedule that you revolve around. That's the entire structure of your week. It's a spiritual connection, and it's something you have no real control over. So yeah, this dark period's a little tough. We got the underwear Olympics coming up soon to check out the combines and the drafting and the scouting. And obviously, the good news for you, Johnny, is the Bears are going to be the number one team to talk about for the foreseeable future, probably until September.
How much time do you got?
Yeah,
we're psyched for the Bear Necessities and all the coverage in the off season and everything like that. But obviously, in our previous show, we did a little bit of the Super Bowl. We did a whole thing on the Super Bowl, and you know, Super Bowl 58 is over. We all saw it. We all saw the chaos. The 49ers had a 10-0 lead vanish, and the Chiefs were able to prevail in overtime. Almost like, I don't want to say the word, but almost like it was scripted. Just kind of felt like it. Overall, what were you guys' takes on the Super Bowl? Can we just bury that one? Was it something positive? Because I got to be honest, I wasn't a big fan of the Super Bowl. Wasn't the worst, right?
Excuse my French here. Can we talk about how fucking boring that game was? That was brutal. That was brutal. And I, you know, like granted, you know, Super Bowl 53 between the Rams and the Patriots, that was brutal too. Like that was rough. That was even more low scoring than this one. But I don't know what it was. There's just something about this. So many offensive weapons between both squads, and for it to be as low scoring and defensive as it was just kind of a head scratcher. And none of the big names really scored. Like Kelsey didn't score, Debo didn't score. Like McCaffrey, yeah, but like it was a weird, wonky play that he scored on. It was just kind of a bizarre game. But you know, credit to the Chiefs, they do what they do best. And
I don't know, I learned my lesson.
You don't bet against number 15, and that's exactly what I did.
And that's exactly what I told you guys on our Super Bowl preview show. Let me tell you, am I the only one that enjoyed the game? I thought the first half was very defensive heavy. I thought that the second half, I thought it became a very exciting game. You know, we got overtime. It was only the second time the Super Bowl's ever gone into overtime. We can talk about the overtime rules if you want. I know we had our debates in our text thread on it, but I thought that it turned into a very exciting game. You know, it came down to the wire literally. Yeah. There was a walk-off play to win. And I thought that we wound up getting a very exciting game in the end after what the first half looked like what that Patriots Rams game was, which was one of the most boring games I've ever seen.
Yeah.
It turned into one of the more exciting games. Sure. You know, the big targets didn't score, you know, Kelsey didn't score. He didn't really come alive till the second half. Kittle was almost a non-factor in the actual stat sheet. He had his plays in the blocking game. You know, that's where he definitely shone in that side of things. A trick play is what got them their first score on the touchdown side of things. But you know, we had not only the record for longest field goal in a Super Bowl, that record only lasted less than 2 minutes because it was broken by Harrison Butker shortly after to tie the game. So right. I thought, you know, we had a lot of really cool things that did happen. And, you know, we also had our first Nickelodeon broadcast. We had Sweet Victory to lead it off on the Nickelodeon side of things. Don't know if either of you guys watched that.
So
that
was awesome. Zero.
You know, I thought that SpongeBob and Patrick, if you saw the highlights from their broadcast, I thought they had some great one-liners. Yeah. I would have loved for them to incorporate that into the CBS broadcast. Would have livened it up. But, you know, I will say that I did really enjoy the game itself. And I will say my biggest takeaway is that, fellas, we've hit the age where we are the generation that they are catering the halftime show to. When we were children, we're like, man, I don't want to watch these old people perform. Mm-hmm. Now we're the generation that they're catering it towards. You know, it started a few years ago. We may have not noticed, but now we're the generation they're catering towards. And we're also the generation that is in the middle. That's weird, where it says, man, I wish they had a lower third telling me who the heck this person is, because I have no idea who this person is. It just came out that they just brought out with Usher. There was a couple times I could have used a little name on the bottom just to know who was with him at halftime. But I mean, I did overall enjoy the game. I feel like I'm in the minority once again, despite me being the only one on the show to pick the Chiefs. So give myself a pat on the back because I had the right pick. I had the MVP pick. So good job on me. I was 5 points away from the total points scored. So good job on me again.
Congratulations for believing in pop culture.
Look at me. Look at me being, you know, the smart one on the podcast for a change.
You deserve kudos. let me just remind you that Johnny still won the pool overall.
I'm proud of Chris. He finished strong. So good on
it's
you.
Not how you start, it's how you finish.
That's right.
It was surprising that we had 3 out of 4 San Francisco picks. I went into that, I'd be like, I'll be the lone wolf. No one's going to go San Francisco. And then Johnny and Nicky obviously had, you know, thoughts on San Fran, and 10-0 in the first half. It's like, this team is a better roster. They should win. The 49ers, I asked this question, and I'll answer it in my opinion, and I want to get your guys' opinions also. What's more true, the Chiefs won or the 49ers choked? I'm leaning towards 49ers choked. Like, I'm sorry. They screwed up the coin toss in overtime. They have one of their best players, one of their leaders, Juice, not just saying verbally, like, oh, I didn't know that. If they score a touchdown, they get the ball back. Like, just a bad look overall. And obviously, a 10-0 lead, it could have been a 24-0 lead in the first half. I almost have this weird feeling that Shanahan is so jaded from having a big lead in the Super Bowl, 28-3. I almost feel like he wanted to keep it close to sort of keep his team engaged. And then all of a sudden, McCaffrey, who, yes, is one of the best players in the NFL, he's got fumbleitis. SpongeBob and Patrick told him to firmly grasp it. He did not listen. And, you know, everybody likes to talk. Chris, to your point, the second half was entertaining, but the first half was like nonstop slop, penalties, frustration on the sidelines, Travis Kelce assaulting Andy Reid. I didn't think it was a great look for the NFL. Usher, no disrespect, he was sweatier than I would be, and I am a sweaty man. Like, that was an insane amount of sweat during the halftime show, but good for him. My favorite was Lil Jon. I felt like the energy in the building was elevated when Lil Jon entered the chat. But
and Ludacris,
overall,
don't forget him.
Unforgettable Super. Yeah, Ludacris. There's others too.
What about the guy that looked like CeeLo Green that everyone thought was CeeLo Green?
Oh, Jermaine.
My dad was like, "That's CeeLo Green, right?" Yeah. And I was like, "I don't think so, Pop. I don't know. We got to check."
I thought it was.
It sounded like him too.
I thought it was. To answer your question, Anthony, I agree. I think it's definitely more on the 49ers choking, but it has nothing to do with overtime. And I'm not buying this. Right. I'm not buying this bullshit narrative of like, oh, 49ers players didn't know the overtime rules. Like they, first of all, that is their responsibility that they should. Good on the Chiefs for having personnel meetings, you know, all week. It seemed like they had meetings on the overtime rules every week of the playoffs. So good on them. But I'm choosing the 49ers because they abandoned what they do best at, running the ball. Yes, I know McCaffrey had fumbled, but when they were handing him the ball, he was getting 5-6 yards every carry. Run the goddamn ball. Like I shouted every week at my Bears, run the ball. You tire the defense out. You open up opportunities for play action. Like, the Niners were moving the ball when they were running it. So why abandon that? Like, did they take a page out of the Ravens book or something? Like why did they abandon the run? I'm leaning the 49ers choked because they abandoned the run, not because of the overtime rule. Listen,
and
I agree.
When it comes down to it, and we were talking about this separately, we were talking about this in our group chat, texting back and forth. Like, the 49ers defense knows that, hey, you know, our team only scored 3 on the opening possession when we got the coin toss in overtime.
Right.
We're gonna have to stop them. Like, it's not rocket science. And forget about the clock, for example. Like the 49ers defense knew, like, we can't let 15 drive, you know, the length of the field and score on us. Otherwise, it is over. So, like, I don't think overtime has anything to do with it. I feel like it's just like an extra narrative, an extra story that we get to talk about following the Super Bowl. And of course, there's all these, you know, blah, blah, blah about who said this and what said that. I'm a big Kyle Shanahan fan. I'm not going to fade the guy. He's had a little bit of bad luck in the big game, but, Their team's still stacked. I don't necessarily think that their Super Bowl window is closed by any means. But I definitely think San Francisco definitely choked on this one because Kansas City let them have this game and they just couldn't take it.
Yeah, and I'm gonna kind of circle back to what we talked about on the preview show, that it kind of played out exactly how I said it would if the Chiefs were to win. Andy Reid outcoached them essentially by having those personnel meetings, and the Niners defense was playing bend, don't break. And if there was someone that was going to break them, it was going to be Patrick Mahomes. And guess what? They broke in overtime. Mm-hmm. And even at the end of the fourth quarter to let them go down the field.
Dog. That's what broke
them. So you can't tell me that one team choked or the other team won it. It's they both played, and you can't tell me, oh, well, we didn't know the overtime rules. Listen, us casual fans knew that the overtime rules are different. You know, we knew that the overtime rules are different.
Well,
we
let me
know
stop
that
you there.
Teams,
I don't mean to interrupt your whole flow, but as a casual fan, I just want to acknowledge something I didn't know. And I think you admitted separately that you didn't know this either. I wasn't confused by the touchdown field goal concept. They get a full possession, got it. What confused me was the clock. There was a moment there where even Tony Romo and the announcers were a little confused because Andy Reid was not taking a timeout, letting that clock go down. And I don't know about your Super Bowl audience. We were kind of like, hey, wait a minute. Is this, you know, like, we knew, like, we didn't like assume that the game was going to end at 0, but we had a moment of confusion. Yeah. We were like, why would they? Oh, it's quarters? I didn't know overtime was in quarters. Can you imagine playing the third quarter of overtime after a suit? Like, that's insane. They're exhausted. They can't go 20 minutes potentially if that could lead to that. So, Chris, I'm totally sorry to interrupt your train of thought.
Yes.
But I think your point is valid when it comes to the scoring. We knew the scoring. We watched the Josh Allen game in the past against the Chiefs. We knew that whole rule change. But I did not know that the clock essentially had no meaning because it was they could take as long as they want on that drive.
Yes, that is the one part of the rules that they should have clarified more so when they go out to the coin toss. The ref even said, does this make sense? Do I need to clarify anything else? They said, we're good. So, you know, it. And yes, I will agree that, you know, I was like, oh, we're 5 seconds away. Like, you know, and then I was, it was getting a little weird towards the end. I'm like, oh, they must just roll it over, which is odd because they get a full possession, whatever the case is. You know, they could have clarified that a little bit better. I was like, oh, you know, if it's one thing, if it's, you know, you have this period, like any other overtime rules, like baseball, if you score in the top of the extra inning, the other team has the bottom of the inning to either tie you again or beat you. If they don't tie you again or beat you at the end of that period, the extra inning period, the other team wins. Basketball, you have a set period of time. Whoever has the most points at the end of that period of time wins. If it's still tied after that, it then goes into another period.
I like same that thing one with football, just throwing it out there.
Yes. So if it was very similar between football and basketball, where it was at the end of this period, if you do not have more points than the other team, you lose. That would make sense. So, I mean, ultimately, that should be the rule. If they want to play another 15-minute quarter, so be it. But state that if you do not score more points than the other team in this 15-minute quarter, you lose. Good day, sir. You get nothing.
That's my take on it too, Chris. I feel like it should just be, it doesn't even necessarily need to be 15 minutes. It should just be 5 minutes or a set time where like a team should not be able to lollygag as long as they want because they have the right to do that drive. And that's exactly what the Chiefs were doing. And no discredit to them. Those are the rules. They knew the rules. But I'm just saying football has a competition committee. We discuss these things every year. The irony is this rule was made because there were so many butthurt Bills fans about Josh Allen. And then in the end, Patrick Mahomes got another Super Bowl ring out of that rule change, ultimately helping them. Yeah, so it's laughable that they kind of do things to please people and then people are still upset. I get that. So I just want to go with what's most logical. If the game is tied at regulation, sudden death is too quick. And then obviously giving people a whole possession. This isn't college. I don't like the college football overtime rules personally. So I'm all for giving 5 more minutes. And then there's always the fear like, oh, what if the game's still tied? Okay. Give me another
and
5 minutes.
Go to another one.
So I mean, that's why I'm saying keep it short, not 15.
So really quick, and we could wrap this up. I do have a question because I was at a Super Bowl party. It was kind of a blessing and a curse at the same time. I was at a Super Bowl party where screaming children were all over the place. Adults were talking over the Usher halftime show. I couldn't really hear the broadcast all that well of Tony Romo and Jim Nance. So do you think that the confusion in the broadcast booth kind of escalated this into more of a story than it really is? The confusion
probably
of Tony Romo and
going,
Jim Nance?
Going down the drive it did. So going into halftime, Tony Romo did make a comment. Oh, the ref summed it up perfectly. We are going into a brand new game, you know, quarters or whatever. And then that was essentially where they left it off. They didn't bring that up again. And then like, oh, you know, the clock's ticking. And then once you get towards the end, oh, you know, you might be asking, why aren't they calling a timeout that's going to roll over? And that was only once there was like 15 seconds left on the clock, he said something. So they could have reinforced that. If the broadcasters knew, like, that was, they could have said when Kansas City got the ball back. Now, remember, no matter how long they have the ball for, if the clock hits zero, they still maintain the ball and we start another period of overtime. That would have alleviated a lot of confusion by a lot of people.
There was just an initial hesitation.
And we wouldn't even be talking about it right now. Yes. It would have been. But, you know, at the same time, yes, the overtime rules changed and it may have won Patrick Mahomes the Super Bowl. But at the same time, the overtime rules they were playing with were a field goal didn't win you the game anyway, and a touchdown would have. So regardless of the case, they would have won one way or another, whether the overtime rules changed before this or not, because they scored a touchdown when San Francisco only got a field goal.
It's crazy to me. It is actually crazy to me that, you know, they're going to get the ball and, you know, they're going to get a possession and, you know, the best case scenario is them getting the ball. You hold them at least to a field goal or nothing. And then you just need to get a field goal or a touchdown. And if you get the field goal, you're like, okay, I need a touchdown. Like, the Chiefs' entire team came to life when they realized, oh my God, we score a touchdown, we win the Super Bowl. Like, nothing else matters. Nothing else everything else was forgotten. The drama with Kelsey, the in hitting the coach, and the poor first half, and the turnovers, and the confusion, and the penalties, and the poor defense, and Spags not really getting to Purdy as much as they would like. Like, all that went out the window, and they just had a drive. And if you're the 49ers, you absolutely have to defer that. I can't even really make any excuse in the world as to why you'd want the ball first, especially when you were so giddy. Like, the only way I could see that is if you're like, we're just going to touchdown now. And they obviously were not doing that. They settled for the field goal. So I don't get it. Nobody gets
it. I do get it. The only logic is that if you score and they get the same score as you, then you now have the sudden death in your favor. Right. That is the logic.
Right.
I don't see the logic. Personally, obviously, I don't even think the 49ers have a great excuse. I think they just kind of were like, we wanted the ball to score. We like to score. I don't think they were really thinking like, okay, we'll score for it. Like, I don't think they really were being strategic at all. Literally, the Chiefs' jaws dropped. And the ref, if you listen to the mic'd up thing, the ref was like, you want the ball? You sure? Okay.
I mean, it ultimately, again, it comes down to the 49ers' offense and defense not getting the job done. Yep. And letting 15 do what he does best and get his team in position to win. And that's exactly what happened. I feel like it didn't matter whether or not San Francisco got the coin toss right
they
or not.
They still would have lost, right?
They still would have lost. They still would have found a way to lose. So, like, we could just, like, move on. I mean, that's where I'm at. I feel like this was just, like, written in the stone, written in the script, as you say. I think this is what happens when you bet against 15. You bet against Mahomes and you know,
and that over-under, man. Like, I mean, if you're watching that,
and I'm 47, and
you're like, it's 10-0 at halftime. Oof. I was the one on the show. Is like, oof. Chris was like, life's too short to take the under. I was like, I don't know, guys. I think I'm taking the under here. This seems like a defensive struggle. And then, of course,
crazy,
get overtime and get the over.
Well, what's crazy, it was 47.5 for the majority of the week. And then, I don't know, Chris, I don't know about you, but I noticed maybe about like an hour before the game, it might have been a couple hours before the game, it moved to, what, 46? 46
yeah,
and a
half?
Yeah,
it dropped to 46.
Yeah.
To 46 and a half.
Yeah, and my fiance was just like, did you see the number moves? And I'm like, what? Yeah, and of course,
wow, your fiance on top of the over-under. I love that.
Just
love
another that. Reason why she is my bride to be. You know, she's putting in 8-leg FanDuel parlays for player props and stuff. God, I
this
love
will
her.
Get
she's,
us a better cocktail hour if we win this, honey. Let's get in on
she's
this.
The best. You guys know that. she was one Garrett Wilson touchdown away from a $6,000 payout on a 6-leg touchdown score. We had to watch the Jets Raiders Sunday night football game. Woof.
Yeah, that was.
And Garrett Wilson had a great game. He had a great game. He just didn't score. We had to watch a Jets primetime game. But God bless her. God bless her. So really quick before we move on, you know, just wrapping up Super Bowl talk. Mm-hmm. Can we all agree that Andy Reid should, you know, live on an island and just eat cheeseburgers in paradise for the rest of his life? Like what else does Andy Reid need to do? I feel like he needs to just ride off
they
into
the
sunset
win the three
on a high note.
They want the
yeah,
three.
Yeah, I guess.
He's more than welcome to join me next week on my cruise in the Caribbean and eating
great.
Some cheeseburgers in paradise.
That sounds great, Chris.
Chris, you're going to have like your feet up on a lounge chair. You're going to look to your left.
Great.
You're going to see Big Red right there stuffing his face with a cheeseburger.
Big Red.
And you're gonna tell him, no way are you winning this three-peat because Aaron Rodgers is going to last more than 4 minutes this year.
I gotta hope so. And speaking of, I will say, right after the Super Bowl ended, the Jets did one of the most Jets things of all time and had a very tone-deaf and very poorly timed decision to say, hey, we're officially changing the uniforms come April. And that's why I'm also wearing this, because this is going to become the official uniform this year. As I had mentioned, it was rumored that they were going to make the legacy whites their official road uniforms. They're going to make green and black ones to go along with it. And they announced it literally, I think, about 30 seconds after the Super Bowl ended. And, of course, the Super Bowl ended with the player that the Jets had signed in the offseason and then
Hardman.
Traded back to the Chiefs,
Hardman,
winning the Super Bowl for the Chiefs.
I want to just point out, he sucks, okay? Great touchdown, awesome place, right time. He had a horrible season. The Jets did not
terrible
question
season.
Their decision to move on.
No,
from
yeah. absolutely not.
Kadarius Toney also sucks, and he scored on the same exact play.
It's really the irony how the players that both the Giants and Jets traded to the Chiefs because they were not good for them.
This?
Won the Super Bowl for the Chiefs in back-to-back seasons. But then as the Jets had a very poorly timed tweet where it was like literally seconds after the Chiefs hoisted the trophy up, oh, we're changing the uniforms in April. I'm like, really? Of all times, you couldn't wait like a day. Like, announce it on Tuesday. Announce it on a Tuesday. You don't get announced it Sunday night.
And also, but anyway, we're giving Hardman the bag to bring him back.
Yeah. At least they're nice jerseys, you know? At least you can rest your head on, like, and they're good-looking jerseys. I mean,
and I will say,
one thing if they were just, you know, god-awful jerseys.
The fans were pulling for it. The fans were hoping for it. We were hoping for it. We were all like, hey, let's make these the primary roads. We really like these whites. Yeah. Let's make the greens. So this Gastineau jersey behind me, I think it's going to look very similar to kind of what this era looked like. So I'm looking forward to it. We'll see what they look like in April. We just got to wash the stink from the last 5 years of the uniforms that they had. You know, they introduced these uniforms, and the last 5 years have just been terrible.
The way to wash the stink is good. Just incinerate the old uniforms.
I'm just waiting for us to do one show, and then you change out that Gastineau jersey for a Wayne Corbett jersey. I'm just waiting for it.
Well, Wayne Corbett is my favorite Jet of all time. I will say that. He's my favorite Jet of all time.
I feel like universally, if you're not a Jets fan, like, how could you hate Wayne Corbett?
No,
like,
he's great.
It's impossible. It's impossible.
As a football fan, how could you hate Wayne Corbett?
Exactly.
You could. You can't.
I met him once. Great guy. Super nice guy. But as I was saying, so that was very poorly timed. But, you know, looking at the Jets in the offseason, you know, you hope that Rodgers stays healthy for more than, you know, four plays. But the biggest thing is the big debate amongst fans is what to do in the draft with the 10th overall pick. And everyone's like, oh, you have to draft the quarterback. I'm going to pull out what little hair that I have left.
That had a good sound. That
if someone
slapped.
Tells me one more time like they should draft the quarterback
at 10. That's how loud it was. That was good.
If someone tells me one more time the Jets should draft the quarterback at 10, I'm going to pull out what little hair that I have left. What is wrong with people for saying they should draft the quarterback? In what planet?
They don't trust that Rodgers can stay healthy. That's what.
Besides the point, you can't put anyone back there and expect them to succeed because you have no offensive line. The plan is build up the freaking wall of the offensive line. That is project number one. Project number one, build the offensive line. You have guys like Joe Alt, Olu Fashanu, Talise Fuanga. I probably butchered his name from Oregon State. Those are probably the top three that you're looking at. Assume that one and or two of those go in the top nine picks before them, and you're getting one of them at 10.
Well, let me cut you off because the draft comes after free agency. If free agency occurs and the Jets make a few moves on the O-line, do you still feel like it's got to be O-line?
If the Jets make some moves in free agency for offensive line, then you're looking at possibly some of those top receiving targets because you need someone to pair with Garrett Wilson, unless that gets addressed by a trade for a Cortland Sutton or a Brandon Ayuk or a T. Higgins or a Michael Pittman. Or you bring in, you know, another Rodgers friend in Davante Adams, which the Raiders say that they're not going to get rid of.
They have to stop doing that with Rodgers.
I know. But, you know, if you bring in another wide receiver talent in the offseason, whether that be through the draft, if you address the offensive line in free agency, preferably not with someone who's aging because that has not worked with guys like Dwayne Brown, that has not worked with guys that they brought off the couch. You know, it has not worked. I really want them to build a strong young core of offensive linemen because the last time the Jets had a strong offensive line was when they drafted guys like Mangold and Ferguson in the same draft, and they had a solid offensive line for about 10 years without having any issues really up front, and they had the strongest offensive line in football for those years.
I really think that the Jets are in such a great spot with that 10th pick. In this year's draft, you guys should be able to get one of the top tackles available, whether that's Joe Alt or Fashanu or the young man from Oregon State. I really think you build through the draft and you build a line through the draft instead of throw, you know, a bunch of money at a veteran in free agency. I feel like that's like the easy way, the Jets way to do it. Sign all these fancy free agents
because
Rodgers. But I feel like Fashanu is for sure going to be there at 10, and I think that's your guy. I really do.
Yeah, that's Dale, really what
Dale I Williams' hope. Teammate in high school.
That's really that's what I guy. Hope because I mean, they've taken these swings on these offensive tackles in free agency. You know, they've brought in Noah Fant, they brought in Dwayne Brown. They brought in, you know, name a guy that they brought in to try and play the offensive
Isn't
line for
draft
them.
Isn't just as much of a risk? Because you've never even seen them in the big leagues.
Yes and no, because you have the youth. Because playing offensive line, it really takes like toll on like your knees and stuff like that, and your joints and stuff.
So, Neal was going to be great. I thought Flowers was going to be great.
It is a risk, but if David Bakhtiari shakes free, are they going to go sign him just to put him with Rodgers again? Guess what? He's coming off of some big injuries again.
They totally will.
That's another guy.
That's absolutely what they would do.
Of course they're going to go get him.
Do they go out and try
slamming beers at Ranger and Islander games in no time?
Do they try to bring in, like a Lael Collins, but at the same time, you have two tackle spots because Mekhi Becton's going to be a free agent, and he also was a liability as it was. So you're looking to fill both tackle spots as it is. So even if you do bring in a veteran, you still want to address the other side of the offensive line as well. So
thing to get a quarterback when Aaron Rodgers is 40 years old? He's not going to be here for very long. Somebody like Penix is there at 10, and then you watch him become a star elsewhere. Like, this is, number 10. Isn't that where Mahomes was drafted?
He was drafted 15? Was he 10? 15?
Was he was 15? Maybe that's why he was 15.
I think so.
All right. But long story short, you could get somebody like Bo Nix or Penix at that pick, have him sit behind Rodgers for a year or two, and actually feel good about your future.
Yes, but the thing is, when you have a guy like Rodgers and you brought him in,
he'd be pissed if he's a quarterback.
It's not even that. You have such a small window when you bring in a quarterback like that, because you bring that quarterback in because you're like, you know what? We're going in to win now. Drafting a quarterback at 10 is not a win now move. It's we're going to build for the future. But when you bring someone in like Rodgers, your plan is now, and then you'll worry about the future later. And that's exactly what the plan is when you bring him in.
I think it'd be a waste of the Jets' resources to use their first pick on a quarterback. I feel considerable needs that do not waste it on nothing against Bo Nix. I think Bo Nix will be a good player in this league one day. But I feel like the Jets need so much help.
Need a quarterback.
I can't imagine the meatball takes you guys here on New York radio out there hearing the Jets should get a quarterback once Rodgers, fizzles out.
Why is it a meatball take to acknowledge the biggest problem this year? The biggest problem Jets had was quarterback this year.
What you do is you go get a good backup that does shake for you. You go out and get a proven backup, whether it be a Minshew, whether it be a Tyrod Taylor, whether it be, a Jacoby Brissett. You bring in one of those guys.
Be like a lock almost, I feel like.
You bring in one of those guys that has proven that when they come in, they can keep you at least afloat or in the mix if Rodgers does go down with a minor injury, not with the sort of Achilles that he just went down with.
I'm sorry, Chris.
Let's play a game. I want to hear
we can play a game in a minute, when it comes to biggest needs, your biggest needs are receiver, offensive lineman, backup quarterback.
Offense.
Your biggest need is offense.
Yes.
And then also what to do with Bryce Huff. The biggest thing is he will probably get my gut feeling is he will get the franchise tag and then get traded because they have a guy named Will McDonald they drafted in the first round, which was a terrible pick in my opinion.
If offense is your biggest need and you have Breece Hall, who you know is excellent, and Garrett Wilson, who you know is excellent, how can you tell me you need wide receiver and running back? It could be O-line. I understand.
I did not say running back.
But we just said they need offense. So offensive line, I can understand wanting to build that. But I just think the most important thing is quarterback. That like any Jets fan for the last 20 freaking years will tell you that. And Aaron Rodgers is not guaranteed to be your messiah. I'm sorry. So you need, I agree, get Minshew, get Tyrod, get somebody serviceable. That's fine. But I can't say I wouldn't be tempted if somehow a nice, juicy quarterback draft pick name falls to 10. That's all I'm going to say.
But as the biggest thing is if you go out in free agency, because you said free agency does come first.
Yep.
Free agency does come first.
Sign a Minshew, sign a Taylor, the conversation shifts.
So you sign one of those proven backup quarterbacks that has, has the backup mentality where they understand the backup position. Because some guys, you can't just go out and sign someone who's been starting and be like, oh, you're going to be our backup now, because that is a mentality. I heard an interview with Jameis Winston last week. He was like, you have to embrace kind of what that role is. He's like, I could start. He's like, I could be a starter. He's like, I believe I could start. I'm not old enough where I'm like, I'm at the end of my career. He's like, I could still start in this league. He's like, but if, as long as you embrace what your role is and you can either help someone and perch them up and you want to just win games and help your team win, do what you can to help your team win. That's what the role is. So you can bring in one of those guys that can do that. Okay. That's your backup quarterback situation. Zach Wilson's going to be out. They're going to trade him probably for like a sixth round pick or fifth, like seventh round pick, just to cut all the losses.
Can we play a game really quick? Let's put our GM caps on.
Play this game, John.
Can we play a game really quick, Chris? I want to get your take on this. Let's put our GM caps on. What value does Zach Wilson have? What could we get for Zach Wilson? Could we get
addition by subtraction? I'll answer the game.
Get a fifth round pick.
I think his,
what's the value for Mr. Wilson?
Maximum value is probably fifth round pick, but you're probably looking at like
You're pushing it
with a fifth. You're probably looking at a sixth. Third day pick.
This is an original from my uncle. When you're trying to, when you have a guy who sucks so bad and you're trying to figure out the rally, it's three words. His ass. That's it. It's over. Be done with it. It's screwed up. Obviously, Zach Wilson did not deserve the hysteria that occurred. The Jets organization screwed things up. We've heard all the reports now about Saleh. It's looked bad. Just move on. Cut your losses. And honestly, in the same building, MetLife Stadium, the New York Giants were not much better with their issues this season. It was just sort of the same story, more or less, only the Jets had a better defense, just offensively could not get anything going. Now, listen, I'm watching the Winter Classic yesterday between Islanders and Rangers at MetLife Stadium, and they had some Giants and Jets at the game. The Giants they had at this game were Saquon Barkley and Tommy DeVito and Sterling Shepard. And I'm sitting there, and I'm like, Sterling Shepard's done. He's retired, okay? Saquon Barkley may not sign here. He's probably doing this as an opportunity to show that he still loves the Giants. And Tommy DeVito has been more or less blackballed at this point, and it is already told that he cannot see the field unless something happens to Daniel Jones, and basically jumped around from second to third string. But the loudest applause, of course, was Tommy DeVito, out of no offense, but also all of the Jets players as well. So I'm sitting here going, what the hell is going on? Who the hell are we? And honestly, as a Giants fan going to this offseason, I feel significantly worse than I did a season ago. Obviously, we're coming off a big playoff win a season ago. I still believe in Brian Daboll. I think he's got some anger issues, but I hope he can, see a shrink or work on this, or do as Tom Coughlin once did and then bring his kids and grandkids in the facility to be like, oh, you're not always a villain. Like, you have a heart at times. You let people see that it could be better. But the Giants have a lot of needs, a lot. I still cannot believe Kafka is on this roster as an offensive coordinator, on the coaching staff. I cannot even fathom that after the year we had offensively. All right, we got rid of the stink of Wink. All the Ravens fans are like, yep, that's exactly what he did to us. He started a bunch of drama and challenged the head coach. So I'm glad we moved on from Wink. I have no idea about this new guy, but the Giants have a fair amount of needs, okay? They kind of have the same argument that the Jets always have, like, we need to fix the O-line. That's the problem. We've been investing in draft picks and free agents to fix the O-line for the better part of a decade, and it doesn't always work. We had a great offensive lineman last year in Feliciano, and then you decide you don't want to pay him, so you move on from him, and guess what? You absolutely could have used Feliciano at the guard position this year. So as a Giants fan, I'm really nervous going into this offseason. I really am. This whole situation with Jones, this whole situation with DeVito, I find it very awkward. I find the whole thing troubling that we have this guy who's just guaranteed to play because he's due to make $40 million and obviously has a history of injuries, has a history of being ruined, has a history of, not even making it through a whole season. We're going to silence the loud Italian with, by the way, the best celebration of the year is all over the NFL, is a better marketing tool than Daniel Jones is, clearly, in about, 8 seconds, you could tell that. So what are we going to do? And every Giants fan and the mother wants them to draft a quarterback at six. Are we really going to have a three quarterback room?
Doesn't it make you sick to your stomach, though, that your Giants guarantee Daniel Jones all that money and now they're forced to play him? And you guys find yourselves in this situation where People are calling for Tommy DeVito to play. People are also calling for the Giants, like, hey, we have this amazing draft pick. Maybe we should go out and get one of these quarterback prospects. That this is such a great quarterback prospect class. Maybe we find ourselves in that situation with the fifth pick. Is it the fifth, the sixth pick, right?
They got the sixth pick.
So this is such a conundrum for Giants fans. I don't know how you're dealing with this because you guys have so many needs as well.
Yeah.
Is there a specific prospect that you have your eye on that that you can really see elevate and boost this team?
Let me answer both questions. So first you asked me if I was sick to my stomach about the Jones money. I'm disappointed that it's come to this, but I have to be honest. When they gave him the deal, I said this is what he deserves. I don't like how they handled things from the beginning. When Daboll came in, they could have just had Daniel Jones on his 5-year deal. They decided to cut that, and that was when our owner went public and said, we've done everything we can to screw this kid up. Let's give him a year to see if he can earn his money. And what happened? He played exceptionally in the first round of the playoffs, and he absolutely protected the football. Did he give you 25 touchdowns? No. But he protected the football. We won the game with turnovers, and he looked like he was starting to catch on. He had that connection with Isaiah Hodgins. I wanted them to keep him. And when you live in a world where Geno Smith is making $36 million, you know, Daniel Jones making 40, you're like, okay. Like, I guess that's just what he costs. The nature of the deal is tough for this season. I'm more disgusted that we have more money tied into Daniel Jones and Darren Waller than we do. That's 25% of our salary cap and two guys that I don't trust to stay on the field. That's disgusting. Now, you asked me about what I want them to do. For a decade, since Victor Cruz's patellar tendon snapped, I have been begging the Giants to get a prolific wide receiver. They have not been able to do it. Darius Slayton is a good, okay receiver, but on a good team, on the 49ers, does he even see the field? You know, he's like maybe third string. So with that in mind, I'm looking at Malik Nabers, or, you know, that's a name I really like just because I think Marvin Harrison Jr. will be off the board. But just because this is the world of Giants fans, I anticipate, because there are a lot of Giants fans that like Jaden Daniels. There are a lot of Giants fans that like Drake May. Those guys, you know, some people are wondering when they're going to go. I highly anticipate that it's going to be Caleb Williams, Drake May, Jaden Daniels in that order, then Marvin Harrison Jr., then Nabers, and then the Giants on the clock. And if that happens, I would say, please don't draft a tackle. Please don't draft a tackle. Please don't draft a tackle. Because
Roma Dunze in that case.
I've seen Roma Dunze. So what's interesting, I've been following a lot of mock drafts. Obviously, my Bears have two picks in the top 10. And we're going to go back to Giants really quick.
We're good. I'm pretty much done.
I've been seeing a lot of different mock drafts with Nabers being the second wide receiver off the board. And then some mock drafts, I'm seeing Odunze being that second receiver off the board. Why Nabers over Odunze? Is there any specific reason?
Height. That's the only thing.
So Odunze is actually the bigger target.
Yeah.
Nabers has more of like the Tyreek Hill effect. Right. The rack, I would call it. You know, the receptions after the catch, just electric once he gets into space. And Odunze is more of that Mike Evans tall, lengthy possession like frame. I'm not gonna lie, Anthony. I can also see the Giants picking the best player on the board. And I would find it hard if Joe Alt wasn't on the board and they passed him. He's like, Chris, I don't know if you've read anything about him. He's only like 20 years old. He's like only going to get better. I mean, Notre Dame breeds offensive linemen.
Yeah.
I feel like he'd be a really safe pick. And I know it's not the sexy pick, but you pick a tackle in the top 10. And I don't know where the Giants drafted Evan Neal, but the statistics and the percentage of picking a tackle in like the top 10, the top 12, like realistically, you're going to get a stout guy and you're going to get a guy that helps whoever your quarterback's going to be. So I can see the Giants going both
right tackle if you're on the Giants, period, because Andrew Thomas is our man up front that we can actually trust. And there was a noticeable difference when Thomas was in the lineup, but let's put it this way. I hope they address O-line in other ways. I hope I want a versatile type of guard more than I want like an incredible right tackle. Evan Neal obviously has not lived up to expectations, but I'm comfortable riding another year with it. And he sprained both his ankles this year. He made that stupid comment about hamburgers and fans. I get it. but I still think he, you know, could possibly have some value there. That was a relatively high pick. So, and they also need another pass rusher, because I don't know if they're going to keep Simmons. I don't know if Aziz Ojulari can he stay on the field. Kayvon has been, you know, okay, but they probably need another prolific pass rusher. But that's
I also would not be surprised if the Giants go out of a left field and draft someone like Brock Bowers, who is a great pass catcher as well.
Yeah.
And I mean, he's hard to place because he plays tight end, but he's very similar when you think about it to someone like,
Waller, this year, I just don't see it.
But at the same time, Waller, how much did he play?
He sucks.
Waller could also get split out into like wide receiver sets. I mean, he's pretty much a wide receiver in my opinion.
And so, when you think about it, we could talk about this more when we get closer to April in the draft. But you know, if you were to have like a Brock Bowers, Darren Waller, two tight ends set. That could be a dangerous threat for someone like Daniel Jones, who does try to, you know, make some plays with his feet and get out of the pocket.
But I said the same thing about Bellinger and Waller going into this season. And what happened? Bellinger's not been the same since he got poked in the eye. And Waller, clearly, unless he's 125%. And I'm not saying this is an issue, but his significant other is still out on the West Coast. Maybe that wasn't an easy adjustment. I don't know. He looked like he was going through slow motion at times, especially when he came back after the injury. So I'm ready to move on. Giants, I hope we can get a prolific wide receiver. That's really the big thing that I want. Johnny, the floor is yours.
So, guys, Bears Twitter right now is a civil war right now. It is a battlefield between Justin Fields backers and the Caleb Williams clique.
I think I've made
my stance pretty clear. I am definitely Team Caleb, but I understand a lot of Justin Fields backers. And being in Chicagoland, there is an emotional attachment to Justin Fields because this kid is so humble and hardworking. He's not a diva. He's not very outspoken. He comes in, puts in the work, and he just wants to win. And yes, the Bears have not helped this kid. His rookie year, he was put into an unwinnable situation behind Andy Dalton and Nick Foles. His second year, he was on a dog shit team that only won 3 games. And then this year, it was, you know, kind of an average team, but like still not good enough. Now, you know, the Bears would bring him back with his third offensive coordinator in his fourth year. It just doesn't make a lot of sense. You bring in new offensive coordinator Shane Waldron, formerly the offensive coordinator for the Seattle Seahawks. Ryan Poles has the biggest offseason ever in Bears franchise history. I mean, this is going to change the course of direction for this franchise for the next decade. What happens on April 25th? I can't tell if
you're excited or terrified by that fact.
I need to remind myself, and I need to remind so many other Bears fans, like, we are in such a good spot right now. Either way we decide, whether that's trading the number one pick, building around Justin, taking a Marvin Harrison Jr. in the top 5.
I've been leaning that way.
Or you go out and get Caleb Williams, who people are calling generational. And whether or not he's generational or not, the fact that people are even terming him and giving him that title alone just suggests the ceiling that this kid has. The Bears have never had a quarterback prospect having terms thrown out at him like that. I mean, it is uncharted territory, and I'm trying to let everybody know that the football gods really don't shine upon us very much.
No.
I feel like they laugh in our face, and at the end of the day, you know, the rest of the national media world that's not in the Chicagoland area, the Bears are always going to be the Bears. But this is a unique moment in time where the football gods are handing over a golden gift. Here, Chicago, take it. It's yours. And I just would find it really hard for the Bears not to reset that quarterback clock, start over with their new guy, and give Justin a better chance at a better coaching staff, in a better franchise that's more suited to work around him and have both parties succeed.
Let me ask you this.
Yeah.
Sorry, I don't mean to interrupt you. You're doing great.
No, go for it.
I just, you know, because I feel like, you know, you're the fan. You see it from the fan lens. I like you guys when you challenge me on the Giants stuff. I really do. My question is this. Why does Eberflus, pronunciation, why does Eberflus get a second chance and not Fields?
I think ever since the acquisition of Montez Sweat in week 9, the Bears defense was arguably a top 5, top 7 unit. And Matt Eberflus was calling plays. Now, I think the jury's still out whether or not Matt Eberflus is a good head coach. Guy might just be a good defensive coordinator. And that's what I'm really nervous about. However, it makes more sense to bring in at this point in the game. I feel like his job will be more safe. And Ryan Poles, general manager, if you bring in a rookie quarterback and attach that to him with the new offensive coordinator, if Eberflus struggles when Justin Fields comes back, like, Eberflus is gone. Ryan Poles might be gone. It's just time to part ways. And it's unfortunate because we've all seen Justin Fields make just electric plays. Outside of Lamar Jackson, there is not a better athlete at the quarterback position. Some of the things that we've seen him do. And yes, he can make throws, but the problem is he doesn't make enough throws.
He definitely holds the ball too long. He holds the ball too long.
He isn't processing it fast enough. And that was a lot of the negative concerns with Justin coming out of Ohio State. If you go back and read some of the scouts' analysis on him, that's what scouts were saying, that, you know, he has issues holding on to the ball too long. He's not processing fast enough. I have not watched tape on a prospect like Caleb Williams like I have for anybody else. I've watched his Utah game, the Washington game. I've watched both Notre Dame games, the one from his Heisman season and this last one. He gets a really bad rep and a bad knock on, well, USC didn't do anything this year. Guy still threw for 30 touchdowns. He ran for 11 touchdowns. He threw 5 interceptions. USC offensive line was borderline malpractice on the interior and on the right side. Caleb Williams is a magician in the pocket. That's where the Mahomes-like comparisons come from. Watching him dangle around the pocket, move outside the pocket, and find an open receiver is like electric. Yes, he's not as big as Justin. Yes, he's not as fast as Justin. But what is he doing? He's processing, and his eyes are down the field at all times. And some of the throws that he makes, whether that's a bullet or he does a little touch on some of those passes. I mean, again, I think generational is a really big, broad term. But, you know, when we hear that this is the best prospect since Trevor Lawrence, since Andrew Luck, since Peyton Manning, it's like, how can the Bears not take that? How can the Bears pass on that? And I understand this whole
Panthers and Young. That's why. Like, yeah, no quarterback is a guarantee. None. Zero. And you already know Fields is pretty solid. And obviously he might not be a generational talent like those names you mentioned, but
you're right.
That's the answer to that question.
I will also, just speaking from experience of 2 times, always be wary of USC quarterbacks.
I agree.
I've been spurned by them twice in my life.
I agree. Mark Sanchez and
Sam Darnold.
And Sam Darnold, right? So I completely get it. Matt Leinart was a bust. I mean, obviously, I think the last good USC quarterback you guys
– Carson Palmer.
Carson Palmer. Yeah, I was going to say Carson Palmer. So I get it, and I understand that narrative, and I totally get the Bears can get a godfather of a haul and build around Justin Fields and all this, but – like, look what Dallas's roster looks like around Dak Prescott. Look what San Francisco is doing with Brock Purdy. It's still not good enough. And I'm sorry, the Bears coaching staff isn't as good as Dallas, isn't as good as San Francisco. We can build this amazing roster, but if you're not able to coach that amazing roster, how good is that roster really? Really, in my opinion, what could bail out a shitty coaching staff is an elite quarterback. An elite quarterback, you're able to, you know, hide those issues. You're able to mask those deficiencies. And I just don't see a scenario where Justin comes back. I think this whole offseason, and it's going to continue even through the combine, like, let's just keep talking about Justin. Let's keep talking about Justin and just raise that value up. If the Bears can somehow get a first round pick for Justin Fields, right now everything I keep hearing is it's a number two pick at the minimum. If they're able to get a first round pick, Bears got to do it. They got it. They got to pull the trigger.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And
listen, I think we'll know more when the Bears make their decision on Justin Fields. But listen, this has been an amazing season of Next Man Up. Unfortunately, we kind of pull the plug at this time for a little while, obviously with the season schedule and everything, but we have our big draft show coming up. I think we'll know what the Bears want to do before the draft. Obviously, if Justin Fields is still on the roster, I think that will tell you pretty much everything you need to know. But listen, guys, it's been great. I'm hoping we can get a submission from Nicky, get an update on the Patriots. Obviously, he's been a loyal member of this show. He's a huge part of this show. But we're going to sign off for now, and obviously thank you to anyone that's tuned in during this time. And as always, be well. And now, finally, without further ado, we'll go to Nicky G's final update on the Patriots 2023-2024 season.
Thanks, guys. Yeah, Patriots, definitely a rocky season this year, as we all know. Not the best showing at all for the offense. Quarterback play, the worst it has been in quite a long time for this team. And that's one of the big areas that they need to address in the offseason. New head coach Gerard Mayo has said that's going to be one of his top priorities, along with wide receiver, which both of those were the glaring holes in the offense this year, along with offensive line, if we want to talk about another area of concern for them. So those three need to be addressed absolutely, whether it's through the draft or free agency or trades, whatever it may be. You go find some guy off the street who can do something better than some of the other guys. I don't care. We got to find some guys who can play better and provide a more quality product on the field for the Patriots offense. As far as quarterback play goes, I mean, the word is that Mac Jones is not going to have his fifth-year option renewed by the Patriots. So as far as it is, this year, his fourth year in the league, is the last year on his rookie contract with the Patriots. Now, whether he gets traded before the season begins or is kept on the staff remains to be seen. We'll see what happens over the next couple of months. Bailey Zappe still has another year or two left on his deal. This actually being his third year in the league, his option will be determined after this season. I've said my views on that before. I would rather him not be on the Patriots team. I think between him and Jones, he is the worst quarterback between the two. I've gone over this time and time again during the season. But if you can somehow get value out of either of them, use them as a trade piece, maybe get a pick or maybe get a player for them, I would probably go with trading Mac Jones over Bailey Zappe, because at least with Jones, you still get some sort of value out of him, despite how his play was this past year. And then the flip side of the coin is, too, if you're going to keep him on the staff, new offensive coordinator Alex Van Pelt is a great guy to have for him, or any of these quarterbacks. And really, anyone is great for these quarterbacks to have, because they need better development. And that's something that Alex Van Pelt brings to the table for them. For, I think, 5 years it was, 2014 to 2018. You know who he coached with the Green Bay Packers as their quarterbacks coach? Aaron Rodgers. You know what he was doing the past couple of years in Cleveland? He was doing a better job with the quarterbacks there, and especially this year with the four quarterbacks in that quarterback carousel they had. Alex Van Pelt did a great job not just developing the quarterbacks but calling the plays for the offense and having to adjust it on four different occasions, and the Browns were still one of the best teams in the AFC this entire season. And, I mean, look at it too, one of the best teams in all the NFL this year. A big surprise to a lot of people, and Van Pelt is one of those guys that they had to thank for that level of success. So excited and optimistic more. Optimistic is what I am with looking towards how he can arrange the offense. He also said in an interview that running the ball is going to be a big priority for him, which should be music to the ears of Ramondre Stevenson. And hopefully if they bring him back, Ezekiel Elliott, because that's got to be a good solid foundation for the team along with everything else that they have. I think for the receivers too, they've got to get something better here, because the play that they've had the past couple of years has just dropped off drastically. I've had my views on Devontae Parker and Juju Smith-Schuster as well. They got to be better. And with that, you can turn towards the draft, I think, for looking for receiver. I think maybe if you can't get a quarterback in free agency, then yeah, absolutely, you want to get that. For draft picks, definitely what I would choose. It's between Caleb Williams, Drake May, Jaden Daniels for quarterback. I would go with Jaden Daniels out of LSU. He's the Heisman Trophy winner this year. Did a great job with the Tigers and one of the best quarterbacks in the entire season for college football by far. I think if you're really looking to shake something up, he is that guy who can do that. He's athletic. He's mobile. Patriots kind of had a mobile quarterback in Cam Newton for one season, but this was past his prime Cam Newton. But someone like Daniels could come in. If you want to put him behind Mac Jones, put him behind Mac Jones. Let Van Pelt work with him too and develop him and get him to a better spot. If you want to go gung-ho, let the rookie take over right away, win the job in training camp, then go for it and let's see what happens when Jaden Daniels runs with the ball, no pun intended. As far as receivers go, Marvin Harrison Jr. is the guy they should draft with that third overall pick as a receiver. If not, Rome Odunze out of Washington, I think, is the next best guy on the board for college football receivers. Between him and MHJ, they split accolades this whole year. Two of the top receivers in college football, very impressive between the two. Odunze may seem like he's the more complete receiver between the two, but MHJ, along with his skill and the name, those both definitely help him out with his draft position and his stock overall and the buzz coming into this year. As far as free agents, though, if the Patriots want to go to free agents for either of those, wide receiver Mike Evans is going to be available for free agency this year for the first time in his entire career. And each year he has had over 1,000 yards receiving. For 10 years in a row, he's done that. And he has been a solid wide receiver for Tampa Bay for years. He won a Super Bowl with Tom Brady a couple years back. He has been electric his entire career and someone who I think would be a huge upgrade and give the Patriots a true wide receiver one on the roster that they have not had in that position in a very long time. He can be that veteran presence, be that wide receiver run, and still be that deep threat that he's known to be in the league and produce at a high rate along with the right coaching behind him. If you're looking at free agents for quarterbacks, I'd go with Baker Mayfield for this one. He did a great job in Tampa this year. I know a lot of us picked him as the comeback player of the year winner, which he did not get in the end. But nevertheless, he got the recognition he deserved by being named to that list. And he has a chance to really do a lot of good with that. And I think with Van Pelt, a guy who he worked with when he was with Cleveland, coaching him, that's a familiar face again. And if you want to bring him in for maybe, say, 2 years, maybe 3 years and try him out on that, or you want to bring him in for just 1 year and let him help develop the next guy, then yeah, go ahead. But I'd say take a shot at Baker Mayfield. He should be the top free agent priority for the Patriots if they want to go that route for quarterback. Other than that, with the rest of the coaching staff they have, they now announced the remainder of the coaches for the staff. Already, DeMarcus Covington, who was the defensive line coach last year, has been named the defensive coordinator. He's a big hire for Mayo. Young guy just like Mayo. Also, we've got Jeremy Springer, who is the new special teams coordinator. Another young guy, too, who's got a great outlook on the special teams. You also have Dante Hightower, former Patriots linebacker, multi-time Super Bowl champion, defensive captain for the Patriots, going to be in his first year coaching linebackers, the position that he played, a great mind for the game, a guy that Gerard is very excited to have on the staff, and I think a lot of Patriots are very happy to see Hightower come back and stay home and start his new career with the team that he played with for his entire NFL career. So I think it's going to be an interesting season. I was a bit more optimistic than I should have been probably with this past year for the Patriots, but I will say for this year, 2024 season, I am looking forward to seeing what happens as far as the coaching staff and how they turn in a game plan for the Patriots. I'm looking forward to seeing Gerard Mayo and what he can do at the helm. Still going to be a very strange year without Belichick on the sidelines, and also having a head coach that actually answers questions for the media. But other than that, you know, we've got the draft coming up in a little over a month away now, maybe a month and a half. It's going to be really interesting going forward. Free agency is right around the corner too. So here's something for the New England Patriots and seeing what they can do this offseason leading up to training camp in the 2024 season. Thanks again, guys, for allowing me to be a part of this. And to all the fans of Next Man Up, thank you very much for watching and listening, and have a good one. Thank you.